vibe going on. It's like Christmas town in here.
It's okay. It's in sync with the last picture. Look at that. Look at that. I don't want to move my camera. I have a tree right there. If I move it, things might just go bad. All right. On the Metal
Voice
today.
Regular Santa's Village.
That's right. On the Metal Voice today. I'm not going to say the one and only, Alan. I got to think of something else. The Voice.
How about our favorite police officer? How's that?
That's right. I like that.
Matt
Barlow.
And one of our favorite guests to ever have on the show. Matt, it's always a pleasure to have you on the show with us. And like we were saying earlier, 9 years since the first album, time has certainly flown by.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, it's great, man. And I really do appreciate you guys, you know, having me on and you know, being so supportive and you know, basically letting me get on here and schlep my music around. It's all good.
As we like to say, pimp it out.
Right, right.
Here it is. This is where it all began. And just so everybody knows out there that Tim Ripper Owens, if he's watching right now, he's going to drop in. We're hoping he's going to drop in. He was dropping in, but I kind of cut him off because I was kind of setting up. But I hope he gets back on. Tim Ripper Owens, have you guys ever done an interview together?
No, I don't believe we have. I mean, maybe there's some slight possibility at a festival or something maybe, but I can't recall. I really can't remember. We've certainly never, you know, worked together directly. You know, we've worked together indirectly, obviously with The Glorious Burden. My vocals are still on some tracks for that record, and then some really awesome and interesting people out there on the interweb, you know, put together some songs where we're doing duets, which is pretty cool too. But you know, we've never had an actual chance to actually do a dueling vocals. So
until this album,
but we won't talk about that part just yet. We won't talk about. We'll wait for Tim, hoping he gets back on to talk about that. All right, Emperors and Fools will be released January 21st, 2022, Rock of Ages Records. So I guess the first question is Rock of Angels Records. Sorry, what did I say?
Rock of Ages. You were going Def Leppard.
Oh,
and it happens.
It happens.
Yeah. Everybody goes Def.
Well, everybody goes Def Leppard one time or another. So, from the last album, and I have it right here, Well of Souls. So, what did you do different?
That's the one.
I don't really know.
The only thing I can say is I think the outcome of this record is a little thrashier, a little bit more of a ode to really, I think the stuff that I started cutting my teeth on in the 80s, and probably the same with Freddie. I mean, Freddie's got a huge, you know, he's got a diverse, you know, influence as well, you know, as everybody in metal was influenced by Maiden. But, you know, for me, I mean, the Bay Area stuff was huge for me in the 80s. It was just hitting hard, man. And they were, you know, Metallica just blew the roof off of it. And then, you know, it was just a giant flood. You got Testament, you got, you know, Death Angel, you got Forbidden, you got just, you know, on and on and on. You've got just so many great thrashy bands, and I know that it was a really big influence on me whenever I was doing my first original band with my brother Cauldron. You know, in Cauldron we were very much influenced by that, by the thrash aspect of it, and with a little bit of Pantera, you know, that kind of thing. But then I sort of started getting away from that a little bit, you know, with Iced Earth. Brought a little bit of my flavor into Iced Earth, I think. But, you know, I got it a little bit more. So this kind of stuff, this record to me has a lot more of a feel of that thrashy, you know, Bay Area sound. I don't know that Freddie would agree with me exactly, but I think that it's there, and I think that people will definitely hear it.
Right. That's what I took away from listening to the album. It just seems brutal. Like, it's intense. You know, the sound is right in your face, and it's relentless. It's a word I maybe use too often, but it certainly applies to this album.
Yeah, yeah, it's not, and it's not. You know, we weren't really going for a really polished sound either. You know, I mean, we were just really trying to make it pretty raw. And obviously, you know, I'm still doing some layered vocals and things like that, and doing, you know, things that are, you know, are for me. You know, I'll admit it. You know, it's stuff whenever I'm composing and I'm doing things, I'm just going, you know, it sounded really good right here. Oh yeah, right there. So that's just me kind of doing my stuff. You know, I'm sure that some people are, you know, like it. Some people are okay with it. And then some, I get it. You know, it may not be for everyone, but, you know, at the end of the day, I don't make money doing this for this band. So, you know, I have to have some self-gratification and self-fulfillment a little bit, you know? And that's kind of where it's at. So I do hope that people like it. I hope that people like, you know, obviously we're not reinventing the wheel, but I definitely want to try to add something to the sound, though we're inspired by that thrashy sound. I feel like I got to put something else on it and put our, you know, our Ashes of Aries mark on it. So,
and here we are, Tim Ripper Owens has joined us. He has joined the party. Thank you, Tim. Thank you for joining us.
What's going on here? You thought this was a Tupperware convention. I didn't realize this was going to be a party. I didn't sign up for this.
First of all, I want to thank you, Tim. I know. Look, I get it. It's not, you know, your release, and you played a small part in it. Well, big part.
I really
appreciate you jumping on, you know, supporting Matt, supporting us, and much appreciated, man. Thank you very much.
Well, dude, you wouldn't leave me alone. I mean, it was every day you're calling me and texting me. I'm like, I have got to get this guy off my back. And what is there another way to do it? Listen, I'm here for Matt, not you guys.
Okay, good. Fair enough.
No, I'm joking. You guys are great, man. I mean, you guys are so supportive with everything we always do. So it's always awesome to talk to you guys.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks, Tim.
Yeah. It's always been a pleasure to interview yourself, Ripper. I mean, first time was in Montreal. I think it was an apartment, and it almost took my head off, but it was a good time, and we've always enjoyed you being on the show as well.
Yeah, that was great that time. That was a nice little kind of a hotel apartment thing I had going on there. Yeah. I feel like I have a place to come stay when I come to Montreal now.
And pied-à-terre, as they say.
Hey, have they fixed the roads there yet?
No.
Okay.
And not going back.
It's an ongoing. That's never good.
Ohio? Come on, man.
So this is a first, Matt. This is a first. We have Tim Ripper Owens and Matt Barlow. Tell us about his contribution to the album, to the song Monster's Lament, an 11-minute epic track.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's funny, man, because it really worked out. Because we had actually you know, bounced the idea. You know, Tim working with us on the last record, and it was actually going to be the song. So this song is actually sort of a holdover from the last one, but we wanted to hold on to it because we wanted to make sure that we were able to do it and that Tim was able to do it. And so this was, you know, this is Freddie's creation. He composed it. He's, you know, wrote the lyrics for it. He basically put stuff where it goes. I helped out with the vocal melodies. You know, I gave, you know, my ideas to Tim, and then Tim just took it and freaking, you know, rocked it out, man. So, I mean, he put his Ripper signature on it. So it's a beautiful thing, man. We allowed, you know, we wanted that to happen. We wanted that to be, you know, just very organic for him. Didn't want to like pressure him to, hey, here you go, you know, do this way. I mean, he's working, you know, sort of outside the lines, but outside the lines, because we do have the composition of the story. But man, he just killed it, man. And I think that I think that you know, fans are gonna really dig it. That, you know, it's me and Tim doing what we do and the highlighting what we, you know, what we highlight in our voices. And I think the song lent itself to being a really cool story and a, you know, pretty dark story at the end of the day. I think folks are going to, I gotta say, I'm playing one of the, and if I'm playing a character, this is probably the biggest a-hole character I've ever played in a song. So, you know, it is what it is, man. You know, thanks, Freddie. Thanks for confusing me.
And Tim, what do you think about participating, you know, when working with Matt, you know, two guys?
Well, it's great. You know, we've talked about it for years. You know, we've been friends for a long time. And matter of fact, you know, he sent me patches and stuff. You know, we have a first responder. My girlfriend's a paramedic. We have a first responder Christmas tree up. It's got all patches from all over the world and all this stuff. So we got, you know, we've been friends forever, but we've always talked about it. You know, people have asked us and asked me and asked us. And I've always said, man, I'd love, it'd be great. And when Freddie reached out to me to do it, it was a no brainer. You know, I didn't even have to listen to it. I knew it was going to rock. You know, the thing about it is our voices go so good together. They're different, yet we do the same thing, but they're different. So that's what makes it, you know, really good. It was a perfect song. So I would love to do more with Matt as well. I mean, it's so much fun. And nowadays you get to do that, right? I mean, I can sit here, I'm in my studio now, and I would call it a studio. It's, as a singer, you don't need too much. So it's kind of nice. My studio is, here's my part. My girlfriend makes candles on the other side. So it's kind of like, you know, that's the life we have now. It's like coffee and candles. There's what we do. But, you know, it's great. It's such a great song to do. So I enjoyed it. And, you know, definitely, like I said, look forward to doing some other songs with him, you know, because it's great.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And I was telling the guys before you came on, you know, this, we had never,
this is the sort of the link between you guys, right?
Yeah. Yeah. We had never
link like together. You did. And for everybody who doesn't know, Matt did the vocals, which we don't know where they are today. Right. But they're somewhere, I guess.
Yeah.
And then Tim comes in and redoes the album or the vocals, that is, right. And me and Alan, I'll tell you this much, me and Alan, I think this might be, I don't know, one of our favorites. Is that it, Alan? Would that be fair to say? Yeah.
I learned more about history doing that record than I did in school. I must say that, you know.
Me too.
And I remember going to Gettysburg, you know, and it was such an amazing experience to sing the Gettysburg piece, but to go to Gettysburg was my first time and to feel that. But I did. I told people this all the time. I learned more about history doing that record than I myself had the advantage of hearing Matt's vocals. So there you go.
That's what I'm saying. It probably the reason why this album's so strong is because in a way it's a collaboration of you both. I'm sure you're using his vocals as a guide track, right? When you're doing it, or a scratch track or whatever the case was.
Say that either, man. Tim did some things that I didn't even approach doing. So, I mean, I think that he killed that record, man. He absolutely killed it. And I especially am you know, honored that he sang on songs that, you know, I helped write too. So, it was, yeah. I mean, but some of the stuff is not like, I can't even, Declaration Day, I don't think is, you just took it and soared it, man. And then I come in and I have to try to do what you did, and then, you know, I'm wrecking myself every
well, unfortunately, Matt, I have to go live and do that too, so and I think, what the hell did I
about
do
his fair play.
What did I do? Why did I do that?
Yeah, what were you thinking?
Yeah, what was me, I thinking,
me amigo?
It was a lot easier at 28.
Yeah, I bet yeah,
everything's a lot easier at 28.
Yeah.
Just walking for me. Okay.
But this is great, you know. This is, yeah, getting out of a car. You know, I go to the gym every single morning, but then most of them just, I'm like, oh, I can hardly move, you know. But this is great doing this. It's great doing this interview, and it's great. Yeah, when Matt asked me to do it, I was like, you know, because we've stayed in contact throughout the years, you know, I mean, the whole time. And you know, he'll message me or whatever, or say something, and we'll talk, you know, personally or whatever, so.
Yeah,
that's why we've always said let's you know, do you want to do something? And I was like, yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead.
We always joke that, you know, Tim's one of the busiest guys. You seem to pop up everywhere at all times. You know, if it's not KK's Priest, it's the Three Tremors. So Matt, how'd you get this guy to finally have room in his schedule to do this?
Pencil you in.
The only thing I can guess is maybe we just hit it just right with, you know, with COVID, you know, and he was available, and it was cool. I mean, I guess if there's a, you know, one good thing that, you know, came from the horribleness of COVID, it's that he was able to do it. I guess, I don't know, but
it was easy though. I made room for it anyways. I mean, I was home, but you know, I was busy, but you move things up the list, right? I mean, you do things and whatever's going, and I do music for a living. That's all I do. So, and that's why I do so much. People say, why do you do so much? I'm like, well, I mean, I could go get a regular job or I could do music for a living. So I'll do it. But I moved it right up. Right when he sent it to me, I was like, all right, I'll do it. You know, that thing goes at the top of the list.
That's nice. Would you guys ever consider doing a show together?
Yeah, I think we're going to do just Matt and myself, and we'll get a bongo player and a spoon player, and we're going to probably do some kind of a kumbaya kind. No, listen, there's not. I think that would be an amazing thing. Wouldn't it be fun? You know, we don't live all that far from each other as well, so we could meet in each other, you know, somewhere here and have a fun night. You know, it's hard with schedules though, isn't it? I mean, Matt's schedule and everybody's schedule is hard to do it, but I think that would be a blast. You know, it would be great if they were doing a show and came up there and sang that song, and it'd be pretty awesome.
Yeah. We'll see.
You guys did play on stage together, right? Yeah. You guys did play on stage together, correct? You've been on stage together in the past? One show? No, never?
I don't think, you know, we were supposed to do a tour one time. Remember you guys were supposed to tour with Judas Priest?
Yeah.
9/11. It was Iced Earth and Anthrax and us, right? That was it, right?
Yep.
And then we were actually on our way to the tour. You guys were, I think, left and we're going there, right?
Yeah. You guys got stuck in Mexico.
We were stuck in Mexico. The Glenn and KK and Ian, they got out quicker than I did because they were going back to England and they were able to take a flight and fly around, you know, America. And so they actually got out of Mexico. I was stuck there for about 2 weeks. But yeah, we were supposed to do that tour together. And I imagine we were probably on some festivals together at one time and we would have had to have been.
Yeah, but, we did. In this that one summer, I think you were singing for Yngwie.
Okay. Yeah.
Festivals. Yeah. Yeah. And we were.
Oh, yes. I remember that. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I think you played my local town back in the day too. We went a local, Ron's Crossroads or one of those rock venue we had. And I remember coming out, checking you, hanging out that night too. So.
Yep.
Tim, when you're in Iced Earth and I got to do Matt Barlow stuff. What was the hardest song to do?
There was a bunch of hard ones, but I'll tell you what, I love Matt's voice, and I'll tell you the voice I love with Matt was his mid-range power voice. It was so freaking incredible. Like, I love singing Burning Times. It was the opener, and it was like, man, it's right something that's, but you know, you got other things that was tough to do. I can't think off the top of my head.
Okay, Matt. But what was, and then you come back into Iced Earth, what was the hardest song to sing of Rippers?
Either Declaration Day or 10,000 Strong.
Oh man, that's
10,000 Strong. Like, 10,000 Strong is tough for me because it's written without remembering people have to breathe. and it's up there. The verse is kind of up there in your natural range, right? So you're just sailing along and it's like, whoo. That's a really tough one.
Yeah. And and it's not really, I mean, I've got to belt it out. I can't even cheat it. You know, I got to just get my diaphragm, like just blasting it out through my voice. I can't like bring it down and try to make it, you know, smaller, you know, the mic technique, man. It's really tough. Like you said, just breathing. Cause I got to breathe.
I was hoping that any day I'd go up to the show and John would say, I think we're going to tune to B. And then I would have been okay. Hey, let's do it in Korn's tuning. I'm like, okay, that's fantastic.
Is that C? Okay.
Let's get the flyers out.
Have you heard all of the album? Have you heard Matt's new album, Ashes of Aries?
I haven't heard it all yet. No, I haven't heard it all yet. Okay. No, I get so bad on listening to things. Now I got to tell you, I go to the gym every day and I put on like the Beatles and I listen to them. I don't know what, you know, I'm in a Beatles kick now, but so I'm going to have to, that's going to be my workout music tomorrow.
Okay.
And Matt, it is too.
Was this new album?
Two more calories off than the Beatles.
Matt, I didn't say I'm doing anything. I'm at the gym. Did I say I work out? I just sit there and talk to people. I'm that old person.
I'm selling candles at the gym.
Hey, how you guys doing? You good?
Are you interested in a candle?
Yeah, I have a candle and some coffee for you. Don't worry all about right. the KK's Priest record. Just get the coffee.
Right.
All right. Matt, was this new album a concept album of sorts?
No, it wasn't. No, it's got some, you know, again, thematic stuff running through it. You know, it's obviously got some, you know, just the title track, which we didn't actually know was going to be a title track, but it just makes sense with kind of the way things are today. That song was actually inspired by a line from The Count of Monte Cristo, where Napoleon is saying to one of his subordinates, and so he's talking about Dantes, that we're all, you know, kings and pawns, emperors and fools. And that's, I mean, you know, you can look around and kind of go, yeah, we're feeling that right now. And so that, and, you know, Primed, that sort of falls in kind of the theme as well, a little bit of that. But there's some themes that are in there, but nothing conceptual, entirely conceptual now.
My understanding is you started writing this album right after the last album.
Yeah, pretty much. And like I said, like, you know, Monsters Lament was, you know, that was in heavy, you know, worked on, you know, we just did finalize things on that. And we really didn't finalize things really on it until we knew that, you know, Tim would be able to sing on it. So, you know, that's kind of where that's at. And yeah, I mean, we worked on some of it, but we weren't like hot and heavy, but we were wanting to, well, we knew with this one, we didn't want there to be that big gaping time in between, like that we had between the first and the second. We wanted to make sure it was like it, but then alas, COVID. And then, so it sort of made it happen even though we didn't want it. We pretty much had this in the can, mixed and mastered at the beginning of this year, but it, just because of production and all that other good stuff with vinyl and all that crap, because vinyl was back way up, getting that out, and they didn't want to put it out without being able to do all the physical copies. So, which is smart. I get that. So we ended up pushing it back. I mean, it's almost a year now. We've been going around jamming to it, you know, sort of kept a lid on it. We tried to anyway.
Go ahead, Alan. Sorry.
I was just wondering if four track cassettes are making a comeback too. I'm not sure if you release it on
what's
that
the production format. On that.
Hey, you know, I guess they could. I'm cool with cassettes, man. Works for me.
Matt, it's fast, heavy, pounding, anthems to somber. Is that it? Melancholic, emotional pieces. That's kind of how they described it. And Tim, on the song that you're playing on, which is Monster's Lament, how would you describe that song? I'm assuming you heard that song.
Yeah, I've heard that song. Well, I think it. I would describe it as a journey, is what I would describe it as.
Okay, all right.
You know, it really does. It takes you in. It's like, you know, watching a movie or something, except you're listening to it. You know what I mean? It's just really got a lot to it, and it just brings you in. You know, the everything about it, music, everything. So it's really something great.
Yeah, it is. Matt, I guess what's the theme behind Monster's Lament? I think you kind of like talked about it just before. What's the theme behind?
Well, the theme about it is, man, I don't want to give it away. It's about
all right,
two guys.
Okay, it's okay. Just high level.
Yeah. You actually have two characters, my character being the a-hole of the two characters. So, you know, at the end of the day, you know, it's gonna be it. But yeah, art imitating real life, as my wife just said. Anyway, so that's kind of what I don't want to give it away too much. I want there to be a little bit of a reveal. Cause you know how that is, man. When you get a record and you open up the lyrics and you go, yeah, you know, and kind of envelop yourself.
But we want to entice people too. We want to entice them, right?
Yeah. But yeah. So it is, even though it's large in scale, it is more of a personal story too. You know, it's a personal story about.
Oh,
two,
okay. I get it. Yeah. I got you.
And I was glad to do it because someone finally took the a-hole part away from me. So I got to pass that off to Matt. It was exciting. I'm like, here you go.
Yeah.
But you know what? It came right back to me. I'm back at it again.
Have you ever played with Freddie Ripper?
You know, I don't think we, I don't think we have. No, I mean, we've saw each other out and about and all over the place. And I don't know. I've done so many guest records and all this, that, and the other. I don't think we ever have.
No. So Tim, are you touring right now?
No, I did. I did that little American run, and then I came home for Thanksgiving, and the day before Thanksgiving, the day after Thanksgiving, I flew out to Spain to shoot some video with some band I just did a little guest appearance with. And then I'm home doing some recording now, did a little recording and and the other.
If you want to work with a band, you know, you're free for that, right? You're
doing that, you know, people say, why do you do that? And I'm like, well, again, I'm a musician. That's what I do for a living, you know, and it's a different era. You can do that now. I probably have 5 songs in line right now to work on. And it's bands from all over the world. Some of them are just amazing pieces. I mean, it's, you know, some of them aren't, but it's really fun because vocally they're a lot, it's different. And it kind of keeps my chops up. I get to write some of them. Most of them I don't. I'd rather just come into the room and have my coffee and start singing. But yeah, you could just get a hold of me on, you know, on social media or whatever, or rippervocals@gmail.com. But, you know, when I'm off and I have some time, you know, it beats delivering people's food to them to pay my bills. So I guess, but I would do that too, to be honest. I'm not one of
somebody. You could always be a cop. Hey, Matt, listen, do you have like any openings? No.
Listen, I'm not going to be one nowadays, but.
That's right, yeah.
But he knows how much I support him. So that I get that. It's really funny that I get stuff from all over America from people giving me stuff, you know, and because I support them, you know, so I big supporter of them, you know.
And yep. Tim, your coffee too, right? You're we got to check some coffee out. Where can people get your coffee?
Yeah, they, you know, you can listen. Most of those kind of things I do kind of for fun. It's not very lucrative to sell coffee and stuff. And I only started the candles, a little candle line, because my girlfriend's starting a candle business and she hand makes them. So I'm like, I'm just going to sell a couple candles for the heck of it. But I, you know, it's not something that's going to do much, but it's fun to do it. You could just go to my websites and stuff like that and see what the hell I got. I'll have anything out there. I mean, I'm pretty sure I'll be taking, you know, photos of what we're doing right here and selling them online pretty soon. So
I got an idea, man. For one thing, I got to compliment you on the labels of the cans, because I love those. They remind me of something. I'm not sure quite sure what. But
they're pretty great, though.
If you could do a leather and stage sweat scent, you know, that might be something that people would like be able to kind of relate to Tim Owens, right? You know,
I think that is it. Or I could do a European version that smells like, you know, BO. Touring
Jackson's got denim and leather scented candles.
No? Yeah. Somebody said to me, that's not very heavy metal to do candles. And I said, so I guess you're not going to buy the limited Judas Priest ones and the Saxon ones and the Motorhead ones, because they're all out there too. So I'm like, well, there goes that.
We have those candles. They're really nice. I got to tell you, they're nice little.
Hey, man, nice
Alan, do you have yours there, the Saxon?
Yeah, the Evoke makes those ones. Very nice. Evoke.
Oh, they're amazing, man. They're beautiful.
It's actual denim.
Yeah, that's the drummer's wife. The drummer's wife from Saxon.
That's right. That's a Glockner. Yeah. Yeah.
Nigel's wife. Yeah.
One spells as denim and one spells of leather.
Yeah, yeah.
See, I can't do that because they already took that. But I just had fun with it. One day I told her, hey, you should make a leather candle for me. She put the first prototype. And I was like, holy crap. It smells just like leather. It was like, this is crazy, you know, but it's fun. The labels are good. You know, Matt, I had a shirt. My touring shirt was Rip Rowan's Making Metal Great Again. I had the same shirt out yeah. like that. It's just a great fun to think. Yeah. I have a few people got mad at me for it. I'm like, dude, it's fun. Have some fun in life. Stop. You know, it's actually not a political candle unless, you know, I mean, it's definitely, I guess you would say the candle is probably more right because it actually lights for a long time.
I don't know. I seem to dig it. I think the left cool.
Yeah, Mokhtov cocktail.
Well, Matt, have you ever thought of doing a live stream with Ashes of Aerie since the touring thing is not really happening? And
Well, maybe it is
over there. Maybe it, no, it's not here. I'll tell you, in Canada, everything's shut down still. Like, it's not really, well, it's not completely shut down, but.
Well, it's actually kind of funny, man, because I, you know, before all this happened, I sort of thought, man, you know, it'd be kind of be cool because, like, you know, Freddie and I, man, we got full-time careers that really take a lot of our, you know, a lot of our time. And what a great way to be able to put stuff out so that people can see us actually perform live, because we can't get out to everywhere. You know, we can't tour a lot. And that's just, you know, that's just the reality of it. You know, we're kind of the opposite of where Tim is at, where Tim, you know, he's working and like you said, he's doing music for a living, and we can't even, you know, devote, you know, a certain amount of time because we just got a ton of other stuff going on. And, you know, with our careers and our jobs, and it's enough to be able to write and do all that stuff. And so, you know, we have to split it up a little bit. We're, hopefully we can get out and do some shows, in support of this record. But again, with the freaking lockdowns and stuff, I don't know what's going to happen, man. It's really hard to tell. It's very, very tough. And I say this, and I've said it in many interviews. I my heart goes out to guys that are doing this for a living, because it's got to be really tough, man. And you know, any way that you can support Tim or anybody else that's doing this for a living, man, do it. You know, buy freaking coffee, buy candles. You know, help out in any way. Do you know, have them do guest tracks, man. That's freaking phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You know, all that's good, man, and all that helps. So, you know, allows, you know, guys like Tim to, you know, showcase their art and their abilities and make some money doing it at the same time. So,
well, Kenny says hi to Ripper, and Kenny says hi to Matt.
Hey, Kenny.
Hi, Kenny.
Kenny, New York.
Kenny Pierce.
Kenny Kessel.
Kenny Kessel. Oh, Kenny. Yes. I didn't see him last time I was in New York. He didn't come out.
It's tough for him because he lives outside of New York, sort of like in the burbs, and it's tough to get in the city sometimes. So
I think he had something. I think he told us he had something going on there.
Yeah. It's a lot of driving, a lot of commuting. So what else, Tim, can you go ahead?
I got to apologize to you, man, because I wasn't able to get out the last time you were in our area either, and you know, just work, man. That's all I can say.
It's hard. It's hard, Matt, and I get it. You know, I get it, and I always get mad at fans when they keep telling me to come into town and then they don't come to the show. And then when you leave town, they go, I didn't know you were in town. It's like, wait a minute. But I never get mad at people because, listen, I like to be home when I'm off the road or I'm done recording in the day. I'll record all day. I like to be home. You know, I mean, I'm that person that just is like, oh, it's pretty hard to get me out. That show better be off early. I'm coming to it, you know, because it's hard. Everybody's busy. I know you're busy and your probably your schedule and the hours you work. I mean, it's got to be crazy.
Yeah. And that's the unfortunate thing. You know, I have maybe every other weekend, but every other weekend is a 3-day weekend of work for me. You know, so it's tough. And you know,
my girlfriend hours gets crazy with the paramedic thing, and you know, she went to New York for 2 months at the beginning of COVID, but she missed tons. When I first started playing, I never played local, so I started playing some local shows, and I don't know if she came to any of them at first because she was always working, and now she's going to be the paramedic for NASCAR races and stuff, so she's the one who goes out.
Wow, that's cool.
Yes, it's pretty great. It's a pretty amazing thing, but I'm like, now you're never going to come to any. It's like, you know, when people got to do it, I said, listen, I'm a musician, so you're going to have to get a job.
Yeah, somebody's got to support me.
Kenny had pneumonia. That's what it was. He just texted. He had pneumonia. That's what it was. So we could forgive him for that.
I've heard that excuse before. I had pneumonia.
I have to say, though, like, after all these years, you see Matt and you see Tim together. It's for fans, you know, it's a big thing. You know, I don't think you guys realize, you know, and to see harmony between you two guys, that's even more important. A lot of new singers and older singers, you know, there's a lot of, you know, I don't know what the right word is, Alan. Let's call it.
Lack of self-esteem.
Maybe.
I don't know.
Or whatever issues there were with the band. You know,
well, I, I think for sure. I mean, I don't know. To me, I'm way too old to have any kind of animosity towards anybody, I think.
Maybe that word's animosity. Yeah, maybe.
But it is. Yeah, I've always, why would there be anything between us? That was the same thing with Rob and I. And that was the same thing even when I left Priest or even Yngwie and me. I don't have it with anybody. And Matt and I were friends beforehand. We had, met or kind of, in passing. But, we became better friends after I became a singer of Ice Earth because you do that. There was no, and you know what? Stu and I are the same way. We knew each other beforehand, and Stu and I are we talk all the time as well. So yeah, there's never any reason. I've always said that. And I always say this, there is some musicians or singers or guitar player, whatever. I don't want that guy going on before me. Maybe they're jealous or maybe they think they're better. If I have another singer, I don't care if they blow me away. I mean, I'm there to sing as good as I can. So with Matt, when I hear him, I'm like, he's an amazing singer. He's awesome, and we're friends. And sorry if it makes people mad, especially the press, that two guys can still be friends,
Yeah, well,
it's great. And we're old. We weren't as old then, but we're,
old plays a big role.
I'm worried more about the lifespan of my candle.
Well, it's nice to see, and sometimes I get it. Sometimes there's contracts or there's animosity for good reason, right? Maybe there's some really good reasons behind it, but it's just good to see that you guys could get along.
And even Stu's
a great guy too, Stu.
I thought Matt was here to fire me because I've been fired from all the bands. So I just thought, shit, is this some kind of intervention?
Todd LaTorre says hi from Queensrÿche.
Todd. Yeah, Todd's fantastic.
Todd's the best.
I'm a little jealous of Todd because he's so good at singing and he's so good at the drums. I mean, come on, dude. Isn't one enough?
Yeah, that kind of pisses me off too.
And he can play guitar too, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, let's just go one at a time here, buddy. We don't have to stick it.
He's a triple threat.
Stab me with a hot poker now. You're really ruining my night. I'm going to have trouble sleeping. Yeah, he's a fantastic singer. When I watched him at the show a few years ago, I was just like, oh, geez. Oh, to do that again.
And I'll tell you something about Todd. Not only is he a great singer, but he's really a down-to-earth good person too. And me and Alan could attest to that. He's not like your typical rock star. So.
Yep. And he's good people.
Some kind words.
Dave, I just want to go back to, earlier you were joking, but one of the reasons we started the show, when everything gets so downsized, to publicize, and I throw this out to Matt as well, to publicize local concerts, it's one of the reasons why we started the show, so that we know who's in town ahead of time, because the budgets are so tight, it seems like people come and go, and nobody even knows you're in town.
Well, we need you to do that, and I'll tell you the problem, Alan, is people... they don't want to look and see who's coming to town anymore. They want it hand delivered to them. When Matt and I were first doing our shows or going to concerts, we would open up the local magazine, rock magazine, and see who was playing all the venues. Or we would call the venues and see who's playing the venues. Nowadays, people want a hand delivered message or a phone call they want to be told. They don't want to look. They don't go to Facebook pages personally. They want it to be posted or see it. They don't want to go search it out. I'm telling you, that's a big issue because now Facebook doesn't really hit anybody anymore. Right. And people don't search for things. My kids, there's no way they're looking things up, like local stuff, what's going on. They want to open up something or see it. Listen, I was doing local shows a few years ago and my people laugh at me because I went to this grocery store. It was my own venue that I had. I was doing an acoustic show. I sent my kids, who were probably about 8 and 10 at the time. One went in one side of the grocery store and one on the other side, putting flyers up inside the grocery stores. And I'm still posting stuff at stores. And my partner at the restaurant said, the local bands don't even do that. They don't even do it. And here's the guy who, people know as a singer going out doing it. I just think it's laziness of people. Not purposely. That's just how they do it nowadays. And we need things on YouTube and you guys doing things like this. And hopefully people will come come to these stage, your show and watch it and see what's going on, you know, cause it's tough. People don't, if it's not hand delivered or they don't get a phone call, they don't see it, but they do see when you leave town. You can advertise a show for 2 months and then you say, Buffalo, thanks a lot. That was a fantastic show. And then someone says, dude, I didn't know you were here. And when it came out, I'm like,
you should write a book, Tim. Write a book.
Well, just sort of, you know, outside looking in, because I don't know a lot about the social media stuff. My wife, she gets the whole idea of the algorithms and all that. But I do think that it seems like that, you know, Facebook has, and all social media has really changed up a lot. It's like they're really pushing you to boost, you know, hit that boost button and stuff more like that. And man, that's just really rough. So, you know, it's to go, you know, keep shelling out cash and giving cash to Facebook because you're just trying to, you know, put your stuff out there. But it seems like it's a lot harder now to get out there to the masses with stuff, unless people are actually organically sharing it and doing, you know, doing that kind of thing, which,
well,
you know,
if you say something bad, Matt, that'll be shared by everybody.
Well, yeah, of course.
If you say, I mean, listen, I boosted a show and I had, you know, 1200 shirtless boys from Taiwan's, you know, liking it because it's fake accounts. And I'm like, oh my God, what's going on here? What am I giving away? That's got shirtless boys from like a candy or something. But I was, but that's what it was. I looked at everybody that liked the stuff that, because I paid for it, was fake accounts. And it was, I swear to God, I'm not lying. It was like boys taking selfies and stuff that weren't real accounts. It's really weird. You do have to, and I don't mind paying for it, but yeah, your wife would know that how it works. It's like, if you post it once, it'll do all right. When you post it after that, you just see it go. I posted stuff about the Three Trimmer show or something, whatever. In the second post, you could see that it got no likes for like 2 days. Like no one's seen it. It's like
they buried it.
What's going on here? You know, except the shirtless boys. They were back.
They're okay.
Yeah.
Well, YouTube is the same problem. Like it started off as once you posted a video, it sort of got a lot of traction, but then they used to send like notifications to everybody. And they stopped doing that. It's like, well, what does a subscriber mean if you're not getting a notification?
Yeah.
You know, they say, hit subscribe, but no one's getting a notification. So what's the point of being a subscriber? You know, it's.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, it's the same deal. All right, some questions for Matt, some questions for Ripper. I want Ashes of Aries. I hope they would play in Knoxville, Tennessee. That's Christy. Put on your list there, Matt.
Yeah, right. I would absolutely
love to. Just go back here because I haven't been looking at any. Damien is one of my favorite songs, and that's from Jeff Tate. Not the original Jeff Tate, just a Jeff Tate.
J-E-F-F Tate.
Christy, again.
At least we know what Ripper's next concert shirt's gonna be, you know, idol of millions of shirtless teenage boys.
No, listen, buddy. I'm not selling a concert shirt. I'm actually selling a concert shirt that actually isn't a shirt. Because then all those boys from Taiwan will buy that because there's no shirt.
Right. It's the new shirt.
It's just, it's nothing. You get air.
Emperor's new clothes.
Yes.
Todd Latore says to Tim, congratulations, Tim, for the new KK album. Very much looking forward to the new AOA album. AOA, Ashes of Aries. Keep on, hope to cross paths in the near future. Have you guys ever shared the stage together with Todd?
Have you ever shared
the stage yet?
I don't think I have ever shared a stage, but again, we probably played somewhere, somehow.
Festival or another, yeah.
But we haven't, but, well, actually, we kind of did, because I jumped on stage with Queensryche in Cleveland and did a little backup Take Hold of Flame, and my throat was fried. I was in the studio all day, and he's up there singing like an angel, and I'm over there going, "Take hold of the flame."
Herman in the background.
If you're given the opportunity to sing that song on stage with Queensryche, you just do it. You know what I mean?
Well, you don't say no.
Well, I used to cover it all the time, right? So it's just like, yeah. And Eddie Jackson was all for it. So he's like, "Get up here." But so I guess we did share the stage together. There you go.
Nice. Matt, let me ask you this. When you did you actually tour with Judas Priest when Tim was in the band? Did you actually play shows, or it was just about to happen, but you never did any gigs.
9/11. So, you know.
Yeah. But did you ever see Tim with Judas Priest?
Yes. Actually, in Indianapolis, John and I went to see them. I think at the was it the Murrah Theater or something in Indianapolis.
Yeah. And what'd you think? You know, like Tim's in the band now. What were your initial impressions?
Oh, freaking amazing, man!
Yeah. I think where Tim won me over, I think it was on the live album. You know, when you did the live album, that's when I said, "Damn, this guy's good." And then I went there and bought
the 98.
It's no, Jugulator came out first, right? And then there was a live album, Live Meltdown. Was it Live Meltdown?
Yeah. 98 Live, yeah.
Meltdown. 98 Live. And then Demolition came out. And I think that's what sold me when Tim was actually on that live album. It just blew my mind. Yeah, it was great.
Yeah, that's an amazing live record, man. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that's it.
Well,
guys.
Thank you. Yeesh, man. Oh man,
I gotta you know, commend you. You know, you jumped on. I nagged you all day and all week, and I got you on.
Well, I thought you said I was gonna be on for like 5 minutes.
Yeah, Canadian.
That's
5 minutes.
Told me. Yeah,
Canadian 5 minutes.
Is this like Canadian time tax?
Anything else you want to add, Matt, about the new album?
Oh well,
shooting shit, you know.
Well, congratulations to Todd, since he's congratulating on his
Rejoice in the Suffering on his album.
Solo record is great, and it's winning all those awards everywhere.
Big awards.
Yeah, it's really, really good. There and then is. He's got the big tour coming up, right? Are they with Priest or?
They're playing with Judas Priest.
Yeah,
yes, so. They're opening up for Judas Priest. Look at that. Yep. Yeah.
I'm certain. I'd like to see them there. They probably won't let me come, but I'll go.
They've reissued Jugulator and Demolition, right?
Well, it's $500 to get it some kind of box set. I mean, it's not like
it's there. It's there finally, right?
Well, I'll send everybody. I've burned a few cassettes if they want one. But that's a great. No, I would go. We're still friends. Everybody, management, and Rob and I, and even Richie, which, you know, glad to see Richie's getting, you know, better and ready to go out there. So, but that's great for Todd. That's going to be a really fun tour. That would be a really great show to go see.
I like how we switched it to Todd. It's all about Todd now.
Yeah.
And the last question for Matt. I mean,
Todd's plan worked.
Freddy coming from Iced Earth, you know, and with them being on a hiatus, do you think the Ashes of Aries can fill that void for that type of music right now?
You know, I don't know, man. I mean, you know, again, you know, maybe for the music. I don't know. But, you know, as far as the touring, I don't know how that's going to work. You know, at this point, again, with Freddie and I having careers that are, you know, fairly taxing on us. But obviously, if we're given the opportunity to get out there and do some shows and, you know, festivals and things like that, that would be phenomenal. But yeah, I mean, I tell people, look, man, we're not trying to be Iced Earth, you know, 2.0. It's just not, you know, it's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to do our own thing and, you know, follow our own path. And so, you know, I'm hopeful certainly that people that like Iced Earth, you know, like Ashes and so on and so forth. And maybe, you know, some people like Ashes, you know, just for the first time listening, maybe they're not even Iced Earth fans. Maybe they'll start listening to it because they dig. It's a kind of a different vibe. So, you know, I don't know, man. You know, we're not trying to walk in the path of Iced Earth or anything like that. I've been blessed enough to be a part of Iced Earth, for that to open the door for me, to be in music. And so that was, you know, phenomenal. And
all right. Emperors and Fools will be released January 21st, 2022. Rock of Angels, not Rock of...
Right.
Rock of Angels Records. I won't screw that up. Tim, Matt, thank you so much. Thanks for being on.
Great having you guys on, as always.
And I guess they could just pick up the album anywhere, Matt? Is this going to be available on Amazon and everywhere?
I think Amazon, they're working on getting the stuff for the U.S. because a lot of people were asking about that on social media. It's just trippy right now, I think, because, you know, Roar is a European label. They're out of Greece, and getting the stuff available in the U.S. for pre-order, people are getting a little bit edgy. But as soon as I hear something from the label, they said that they're going to let us know as soon as they know when it's live on Amazon in the U.S. And that's probably the best way to get it. I mean, that's, you know, look how things are today. That's pretty much where it's at. But if there's any other venues, any smaller mom and pop shops or anything like that, I'll certainly put those out there as well. So I want everybody to make money off this if they can. And, you know, since Freddie and I don't.
Somebody has to.
We'll do it. Yeah, so I'll let folks know as soon as something's out there.
Thanks, man. And Tim, what's up? What's next for you? What are you going to be doing next? What's the big thing in January?
I'm either probably going to put a bunch of songs out or go to prison. One of the which direction I'm going at, because I'm going to have to rob a bank or something. First of all, I'm going to be pushing. When people want to know about the record, this record that's coming out, it'll be on my social media pages as well, because I'll be promoting. Right. Like crazy. But yeah, you know what, I'm recording here and gonna head out to England eventually in the new year and probably hang out with KK and the guys. We'll probably do some rehearsing, and I know he's mentioned we're going to start writing a new record. We might try to record it while we're waiting to go on tour, because it's not an easy band to get on the road, because it's not like you're playing small venues. He's not playing small venues, he's only playing big venues. So we're going to go out there, rehearse, and get everything together, maybe start recording, and then start touring next year.
All right. That's it. Alan, do you have anything to add?
Todd Latore wishes Matt's son a happy birthday before we go here.
Oh, awesome.
Nice. That's nice. It always goes back to Todd. It always goes back to Todd.
Todd always watches.
Is Todd's, is he like looking shit up now? He's just trying to outdo a song. He's like, hey, and Tim, nice pants.
Sings like an angel, plays drums, plays guitar, and a trivia, has all these facts stored in his head. He's amazing.
We should have had Todd here as well. I think he's trying to hint into it.
It's okay. Todd will be on next time. It's all good.
All right.
Yeah, that would be fantastic. How about us three singers, the new three trimmers? That would be amazing.
Don't tell Sean Peck. If we call it the new three tremors, though, is that okay? I think legally you can do that.
Mach 2?
Neo tremors.
You know what? We'll have an East Coast and a West Coast. So we're going to have to transfer an orchestra, but we'll have an East Coast.
Tim Ripper's three tremors.
No, my name's not good. That takes people away from the show. We want to minus the crowd.
Matt Barlow's three tremors. Okay.
How about New Shimmer? You know, it's a floor rack.
Anyway. Sean Peckle, love that. All right. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.